So in today's class, we are going to see about multiple interfaces. Then we will see something called for each loop. Then followed by some GUI program, that is graphical user interface program called Applet. Then we will go for some threads. Then we'll see what are the different types in which we can implement the threads like that. Then we'll see some functionality of thread like thread sleep and so on. Okay. So first I will mute everyone so that I don't affect others. Okay. So now we'll see about multiple interfaces. In the previous class, we have discussed about multiple interfaces. So interfaces are nothing but it's similar to a class. It will have a methods. All the methods are said to be abstract, and the implementation of the abstract methods can be implemented as the subclasses of the interfaces. So far we have seen a simple program about the interface. So now we will see about multiple interfaces, because Java doesn't support multiple inheritance, but we can implement multiple interfaces, which is similar to like multiple inheritance like that. So we'll start. So I'm going to create a new program. So I'm going to create a new program called class interface multiple demo. So then I will create public static void main. Followed by the default thing string ARJS like that. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to create two interfaces. So mainly like the first interface is like interface one like that. So second interface is interface two like that. So I'm going to create like a subclass called interface multiple demo, so that it will implement both this interface one and interface two like that. So I'm going to create a method called something called void display like that. So which doesn't have any implementation like abstract method. So similarly, I will use another thing like void display two like that for the second interface. So what I will do is I will write an implementation in the subclass. So the subclass can be implemented by the help of the keyword called implements, followed by the interface, the one, comma, interface two. So this is the syntax. So we can write, we can create a subclass called interface multiple demo, which implements the first interface as well as the second interface. So we have created like this. So we have created something called interface one. Then we have created interface two, and that can be extended by, or that can be implemented by, by a subclass called interface multiple demo. And this first one interface have a display method in it, and this will have a display one method in it. Sorry, display two method in it. So we are going to write an implementation here. So before that, I will put. So everything has mute. Okay. So now what we'll do is we'll write an implementation for void display. So I will write the implementation void display. So I will write some logic like system dot out dot println. So I will write implementation of interface one like that. So similarly, I will write the second method void display two. I will write implementation of interface two like that. So what I have did is I have created two interface, namely the interface one, which is having a method display, and interface two, which is having another method display two. So using this subclass interface multiple demo, I'm going to implement both interface 1 and interface 2. And I'm going to write the implementation of this display and display 2. So now I'm going to create object for this, and I'm going to call display 1 and display 2. So IMD equal to new display, new class, like class followed by object name equal to new class name. Then IMD dot display. So this will display the first one, and IMD dot display. So this will display the second one. So I'm going to save this as the file name interface multiple demo.java. So I'm going to compile it. So Java C, then followed by interface multiple demo.java. So it's showing an error like display is interface multiple demo cannot implement display in interface 1. There is some error. Yeah, so we have to put that as public because it has to be accessed. So I can put that as public. So now it can be implemented. Oh, sorry. So I have to put public here. Sorry. Like public like that. So now I will compile this. So when I press enter, you will get the result of implementation of interface 1 as well as implementation of interface 2. So this is how we can implement multiple interfaces. So we can create many interfaces like interface 1 and interface 2, and we can implement with the help of the subclass like interface multiple demo implements interface 1 comma interface 2 like that, which is similar to multiple inheritance, but this is like multiple interfaces, and we have to write the implementation for this one as well as this one, like display method as well as display 2 method, and we have to put like public because it should be accessed here, so we have to put that as public. So this is all about multiple interfaces, and we will see another scenario where suppose if interface 1 is having display method as well as interface 2 is also having an interface method, and what happens if we create like this, assuming that this is the same method and this is the same method. So I'm going to create a subclass so that it will implement both interface 1 and interface 2. So assuming this display method is implemented here, and this display method is implemented here. So now when we compile this, you will get an error. The first thing is like display is already defined in interface multiple demo. That means there is multiple multiple display method is declared. So we have to delete this. And if we delete this, when you again compile this, you will not get any error. When you run it, so you'll get only the implementation of interface, because like if we have like interface 1 with the same method that of interface 2, for example here is this display as well as display here, and like as we know that we can't able to create a multiple like methods with the same name with the same arguments like that. So what we can do is we can create a single method so that it is an implementation of interface like that. So if you call that, you will get this result. So in multiple interface, we have to make sure that so this method we can add, and this method it should be like a different name. So what we can do is we can put like public void display here. We can put public void display 2 like that, so that we can create an implementation of it, and we can create an object for it, and we can run it. Okay. So any doubt about this? I'm going to teach you So the next topic, it will be like the use of for each. So the for each, normally we will be using for loop. So I'll be writing a program. First, I will write a program for demonstrating for loop, and we will see how to modify the for loop for this for each loop. So this for each loop is an advanced version of for loop, in which we can write a simple code, and it will be very effective to implement. So first, let me create a simple program, maybe like array demo, like that. Maybe like array demo, so that I will create some array, and using for loop I can print that. And the same thing with the help of for each, we can print that. So I will be creating args. So I have created a simple Java program. So first, what I will do is I will create some array. So array can be created like this. So we can create like this, like 10, 20, 30, 40, 50. And this is like an integer array. And I have created an array with a size of 5. And with the help of normal for loop, what we can do is we can create some a variable like int I equal to 0, then I less than. Maybe if you know the length, you can put like 5 directly. Or what we can put is, we can put array dot length like that. So it will take the length of the array directly, which is like the length is 5 here. So since we are starting from 0, so it will be I less than a dot length. So using the simple for loop, like using the older version of for loop, we can do like that. So I'll be printing that with the help of AI like that. So AI is like an index. So I'll be saving this. So I will save this, then I will compile it. So Java C array demo dot Java. So when I run it, okay, so I'll be getting 10, 20, 30, 40, and 50. That is the array element. So what we are doing is, we have created like a for loop with the initialization of I equal to 0, I less than A dot length. A dot length is a static variable. So it's like it will help us to get the length of the array. Then using the increment thing, we can increment the value. So initially I equal to 0, you get a of I, a of 0 equal to 10, then a of 1 equal to 20, a of 2 equal to 30, a of 3 equal to 40, and a of 4 equal to 50. Now like I is less than a dot length, so it will stop executing and it will come out from this for loop. So this is like a olden way in which many of us will use this for loop. It's like we will use this kind of for loop in C, C++, Java, and some kind of thing. But instead of using this for loop, so there is another for loop like for each loop. So what we will do in for each loop is, so we will create a variable like that, for example, int I. Okay. So instead of putting like int I colon I less than or equal to a dot length or I plus plus, we can directly put a colon. That means int I in A. So that means int I in A. That means, so it will take the first value of I, first value of A, so 10, then second value, then third value, then fourth value, then fifth value, like that. So this kind of syntax is said to be a for each syntax. So to print that, we'll use the same kind of things like system.out.println like that. Then we'll just put I. Instead of A, we'll just put I. So what it will do is, first it will take each element in the array, like it's like I is considered to be 10 for the first time, then I is considered to be the second position for the second time, then for third time, then for the fourth time, and then for the fifth time. So then after that, there is no value in the array, so it will come out from this for loop. So now we'll compile this. So we'll run this and you'll get the same result. And this kind of for loop is said to be for each loop. So this is called as for each loop. For each loop. So this kind of loops are used in Python kind of version where directly they can use this. They won't use this kind of the older way of for loop. Instead, they will directly go for this kind of steps. And this is like better to use because when we go for like Spring framework and other stuffs, we have to work with an object or we have to work with the collections like linked list, like list and everything. So instead of going for the older way of for loop, we can use this kind of for loop so that it will be very short to write as well as it will be it will helpful for like it will helpful for many ways. So when we go for that, we'll discuss briefly about this kind of for each loop. So any doubt? So the next topic is applet. Okay. So applet is the thing. It's like a GUI version of like there are two kinds of initially Java has two kinds of programming. One is application programming and another one is said to be applet. And nowadays this applet is not used widely by any developers because instead of applet they are going for something called swing. They are going for something called swing. So using this swing, they will create a lightweight process. That is, they will create a component with ease. And initially, like when they started developing a GUI program, the Sun Microsystem, they have used something called applet. And like you know that in 1990s, there is like they have started the internet, and we have like initially it started in 1990s. And it was like the first browser, I don't know the name of the browser, but the browser, they use this applet kind of thing for creating any animation in the browser. And like that, they use this kind of applet. But it is like heavyweight, I will tell you why it is heavyweight like that. Since it is heavyweight and it is a heavyweight process, we won't use this kind of applet while designing a complete project or while designing a project. So instead we'll use something called swing. So first what we'll do is we'll learn about applet. So then we'll go for threads and we'll just ignore the swing because we are going to develop application with help of web. So if you want to develop application with help of basic GUI of Java, we can go for swing, but we are going to just omit this swing. Okay. So we'll just go for applet. So applet is nothing but it's another kind of Java program, but it's completely like the execution of this applet is completely different. So let me start writing a program. So first what we have to do is you have to import something called import java.applet.applet. So this first we have to import. It's a predefined class. Maybe you can check it here. So Java p space Java dot applet dot applet. So you can see this is a predefined class. Comes under Java dot applet dot applet. You can see this is like it will help you to create a GUI kind of application for Java program. And this comes under the package java.applet. So I have given import java.applet.applet. Then you have to create another thing called. So what you will do in GUI, maybe I will take a small quiz. So what kind of application you will do in GUI? That is graphical user interface. So you can type in your chat. What kind of application we can do in GUI? So answer, it is in GUI. The word, it is in GUI. Okay, we can create games, but the games, it is like, the answer, it is, it belongs to the word GUI. It's the first word of G. So that is graphics. So what we can do is, we can create another package like import java dot AWT, that is AWT is an abstract window toolkit, which will have all the graphics application. So we have to include that as well as here. So we can also explore that, like Java P. I think is the command prompt is visible for everyone. So maybe I can change the font color. So screen background, maybe I can take white. So screen text, I will take black. So now is that visible? Okay. So now what I can do is, so I can type Java P space Java dot AWT dot graphics. So this graphics, so this is the applet which help us to create an application for GUI. This graphics will help us to draw something in our applet. So you can see, like, we can draw a line, we can fill a rectangle, we can draw a rectangle, we can draw something like we can draw a polygon, we can draw some we can draw some string like that we can do. Okay, so this is like creating a structure is like java.awt java.applet.applet, and do some drawings is said to be java.awt.graphics. So then we have to do the same thing, like public class followed by the class name. So I can put applet demo. Applet demo. So this applet demo should extends the predefined class called applet. This is must for every applet program. It must be extended with this applet, else it won't work. So now we can put public void paint. We can put public void paint. We can put public void paint, paint followed by graphics G. So this is like similar to a public static void main. So this is similar to our public static void main. So like public void, so we will paint something in the applet. So this is like public void paint. And by default, we are going to pass some graphics into this paint to paint that. So this is must actually. So then I'm not drawing anything. First, I'm going to save this file as applet demo.java. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to first compile it. So Java C applet demo.java. And to execute this applet demo, you can't able to use this like Java space applet demo like that. You should not use this applet demo, because when we have public static void main, maybe you can use this command Java C to run that. But the thing is we are using applet program, so the execution part it should be the different one. So to execute that, the command is you have to type applet viewer, that is applet viewer, applet viewer followed by applet demo dot java like that. So when you press enter, so it should work actually. But to make the applet visible, so we have to include one more thing, like a command line for this applet. So this is multi command line, so we have to include something called applet code equal to applet demo. So then we have to specify the height of the applet, maybe like I will use 100 pixel. Then width of the applet, maybe I will use some same 100 pixel like that. Then we have to close the applet. So now what you will do is you can compile it and you can execute it. So can you all able to see my screen? I think some of you are messaging that they can't able to view the screen. Yeah, others they can able to view the screen. Maybe what you can do is Nivela, maybe you can just perform a logout and login so it will work. So now I'm going to save this, then I'm going to compile it because I have modified the code. So I'm compiling that, then I'm going to run that with the help of Applet Viewer. So when I press enter, you can see the applet window here, but it doesn't print anything because we have not given anything. So to print that, what we'll do is we'll go for this like javap java.awt.graphics. Now we will see, so this will have many AWT. So these are said to be AWT tools. Like if you want to draw something, you can put if I want to draw a rectangle, I can put some four coordinates, it will draw. If I want to draw some string, I can directly put. For example, if I want to draw string, so what I can do is I can put the text of that string followed by the X and Y position of the screen so that it will display. Maybe we can take this one. So what I will do is I can, so we'll take this one out. So first we'll take G dot draw string, where it is. Yeah. So G dot draw string, draw string. So first we'll give some input like hello, like that, followed by the position of the string. For example, like position of the screen, I'm going to start with the 10th position and I'm going to end with the X, Y axis 20, like that. X axis it will be 10 and Y axis it will be 20, like that. So now I am going to compile it. So I'm going to execute this. So you can see the word hello here. So it starts with a X value 10 and a Y value 20. So it will be like this. The position, it will be like this. So it will be, so we can have X axis here. Then we have Y axis here. So we have taken some point around 10, 10. So that in 10, 10, the string will be displayed like that. Okay. Now we'll draw something which is of shape. So we'll draw something which is of shape. So I'm going to explore that. So to draw that, maybe we'll go for rectangle. So there is no draw. Okay, here we have draw rect here. So I'm going to draw that. So I have to give a position, like some position. So I'm going to execute that. Okay, so it will draw the rectangle for us with the starting position 10, 20 and the ending position of here. So this 10, 20 is like this leftmost top corner of the rectangle, and the rightmost bottom corner is like 50 and 50. So this is how we can create a rectangle like that. Then we can have different types of thing. So you can explore that and you can do that. And we'll have some different life cycles of applet. So the life cycles can be like, you can see in the command prompt, maybe if you type javap space java.applet.applet. So you can see the life cycle like init, start, stop, destroy, like that. So this is the life cycle of the applet. Maybe let me just put some content in it so that you can explore that. So I will put like system.out.println, like that. So to just make sure that we are just seeing everything, like, so then we'll just explore. So then start, then we have stop, then we have stop, then we have destroy. So now what it will happen is when the applet is loaded, it will start this, and when the applet is after loading, when it opens to the user, it will just call the start. Then when we close that applet, it will call the stop and destroy. So maybe we can just see that practically. Maybe so if you maybe I'm going to compile it. So first I will go to the desktop, then week three. Three, then Java applet demo, like that, demo.java. Okay, so I have to delete this. It's already done, it's public. Okay, I have to delete this one. Okay, compile it. So to run that, I will type applet viewer applet demo.java. When you see here, it is starting the initialization, then it starts. Now the applet is loaded. Now when I close this, it will call the stop and destroy. So this is the life cycle of the applet. So that you have to understand. Okay. So there are many animations we can do with help of this applet. In olden days, like they will use this kind of animation and they will put it in internet. With a old very internet explorer like kind of thing, and they will do that. For example, if I want to embed that in a web page, what I can do is I can simply create a web page. Maybe like I think you all are familiar with HTML. If you don't if you are not familiar, you just we'll just go for this HTML in the next courses, like after completing the core Java. But it's very simple. I'm not doing anything. I will just save this as something like index.html, like that. Okay. So this is now like a page. Now I can open with the Internet Explorer so that this applet will be executed in our screen. In our web page. So, hello block content. Later. So I think this will take some time. Okay. Yeah. So now you can see this, the thing is loaded here. But maybe since the application, this applet kind of thing is a very older kind of thing, it is blocked. Maybe if I select OK, maybe it will run. Yeah. So this will go. This will show you this. The blocked information. Maybe if I ignore again, it won't work. But when we use the old type of Internet Explorer, this kind of stuff it will work actually. But due to some security problem, it is blocked by this Internet Explorer. So this is all about like applet. So we can do many like animation kind of stuffs here with the help of this applet. And the execution step for this is slightly varies from Java. So for compiling, we have to use Java C followed by filename.java. To execute that or to display the applet, we have to use applet viewer applet demo.java. So you can see that applet viewer when you explore the software which is you have installed. For example, when you go for like public, when you go for the C drive, then when you go for Java, then you go for bin, you can see many things like Java is there, Java C is there, and also you can see something called applet viewer is also there. So this will help us to execute this applet. Okay, so to execute the applet, we have to use applet viewer applet demo.java. Suppose if you ignore this, it will compile and it will not execute the applet. So to display that, we have to use this code. And what we are getting is when you initially run this applet, sometimes you'll get this kind of error, like can't read applet viewer properties like that. But when you execute again, it will work. So this, when you execute the applet for the first time, it will give you this error. Then when you execute it for the second time, it will work. Okay. So this is all about our applet. Okay. So now we are going to see about thread. Thread is nothing but it's a lightweight process normally. Threads are otherwise called as lightweight process, in which we can do like many multi-threaded applications like that. Okay. So threads, for example, consider the two scenario in which the first scenario that uses the concept of like there is no concept of thread, but when you go for the second scenario, you can see something called thread. What happened is, assume there is a software and you have to perform a login, and with the help of the module user validation, you are performing the login. Okay. And after performing a login, maybe assuming this login takes 5 seconds, and after performing a login, you are taking some report of some activities, like assuming you have created a banking software. First you are performing a login, then you are performing something called taking a report, for example, how many customers have deposited or what are the amounts are deposited, like that. And after that, you are just updating the software. Okay, you are with the help of something called maintenance module, like that. So there are three modules which takes three different times. For example, the user module takes 5 seconds, and the process of report, which it takes me, assuming that it takes some 5 minutes, and the process of maintenance, which takes 10 minutes, like that. So the total overall execution, it will be like 15 minutes and 5 seconds. Okay. But what we can do is, instead of executing this process report and maintenance in a separate manner, we can do it that we can do that concurrently or parallelly with the help of thread. For example, when you go for this threaded environment, the same kind of scenario. First, the user validation performs with the help of 5 seconds maybe. And when you go for the process report, maybe it takes some 10 minutes. And while doing the process report, we can take the maintenance. So parallelly, we can do that. So the parallel kind of operation can be done with the help of these threads. Okay. So if we have more than one thread, then it is said to be a multi-threaded environment. So today we will see about threads and what are all the different ways in which we can implement threads like that. So threads are nothing but it's a lightweight process which will be used in many applications, because many applications, they are using multi-thread. For example, our operating system itself, it's a multi-threaded environment. For example, what I can do is, like you can see a task manager by the background, it's doing plenty of thing for us. Like when you go for services, this kind of services are executed at the background. Like you can see the BitTorrent is executed at the background. Then you can see some antivirus, it is executed at the background. Then printer software, it's executed at the background, like kind of stuffs. So execution of task is also is said to be thread. Okay. So this thread is like, which will help us. The advantage of thread is to reduce the number of work and also to execute the task parallelly as well as in the concurrent manner. Okay, so it is best that everyone should know this concept of thread. So like thread is a very important thing. So I will spend plenty of time for creating this thread. Okay, so now let me write a code for this. So what we can do is, before that, I will ask you some questions. What is the base class for all the class in Java? What is the base class for all the class in Java? Object, okay. What is the base class of all the exception in Java? Exception. Similarly, the base class for all the threads in Java is thread itself. Okay, so we can do it with help of the thing like Java p space Java dot lang dot thread. So you can see there are thread is the base class for all the thread. Okay, and there is a method called run. Okay, there is a method called start and like that kind of thing. Okay, so this run method will help us to create application. This start method will help us to start the method. For example, when we create a program, you will understand that. Okay, so first, what there are two ways in which we can create a thread. For example, the first way is like I'm going to create a thread one like that. So this is the thread, and I'm going to create a thread demo. This is the main program. So I will have like public static void main string args like that. So now this is the main program. You see, this is the main program, and this is the separate task. Like this task is said to be a thread one. Okay, so this thread one should extends the predefined class called thread. Okay, and I'm going to create a method called public void run. So you should not use different method name, because run is the method name that is already given in the thread class. I'm going to override that. Okay, so I'm going to override the run method, and I'm going to do that. So I'm going to override the run method. I'm going to print something like system.out.println like that. Printing thread like that I will do. Now what you can do in the main program is you can directly create object for thread one, t1 equal to new thread one like that. Now what is the method for, what is the method we have to execute? Can you just all put in the chat? So I have created the thread object like thread t1 equal to new thread. How will you call this run? How will you call this run? Okay, so some of you have given that t1.run. Okay, so what happens if you give t1.run? Okay, so I'm going to save this as thread demo.java. Okay, so I'm going to compile it. Java C thread demo.java. Okay, some problem. So sorry, so I have to go to the desktop. I have to go to week 3. Java C thread demo.java. So I compiled it to Java thread demo. When I press enter, I am getting the result. What actually it does is it is not creating any kind of thread. The reason is this program consider this as the ordinary method, and it is not as the run it is not like a thread method. So you can see that with help of command java p space thread demo dot class, you can see there is no thread is called here, because this program, what we are doing here is right, like public void run is right, and we are implementing this part is right, but this part is like it's a wrong one, because to execute this run we have to use something called start method. Now what it will do in the start thing is it will execute this run method, and this kind of execution is called as thread. Now if I compile it, I will get the result. Now this kind of execution is a thread kind of execution, and it's not showing. I think there is a command to show here, like the difference between, and here it will show some thread like that. I will just check and I will tell you. So to execute this thread, so public void run. So run method can be called with help of start method. Suppose if you use here run, it will execute the, it will execute and it will give you the result, but it will not consider that as the thread. It will consider that as the ordinary method with the name run. Okay, so now let me so this is like one way of creating a thread. So with the help of the predefined class called thread, and using that we can extend that. So this is one type of inheritance. Okay, and what happened, like if you use a multiple threading, so whether we can use this kind of technique or what. So I want to use multiple thread, which is the best way. So the main drawback of this thread is, like if you use multiple thread, you can't able to use extends keyword. Okay, so there is a second way of implementing a thread, that is instead of extending a thread, we can use something called implements runnable. Implements runnable, and it will have the run method in it, and the execution it will take some different way. Like first we have to create the object for this class thread one, t1 equal to new thread one. Then we have to pass this object to a predefined thread, maybe like t main. I would say is equal to new thread of, we have to pass this t1, so that this will be considered as the thread instance. Now using this tmain.start, we can execute. tmain.start, we can execute. So this is the second way of implementing the thread. So you'll get the same kind of thing. Okay. So this is all about the implementation perspective of thread. So we have two ways of implementing the thread. One is by extending the base class thread, and another one is by implementing the runnable called interface. Okay. So while you extend that, we have to just create an object for that class, and we have to use start. Similarly, when you do for with the help of runnable, so first we have to create the object for the class, and you have to pass that object to a thread class constructor. Then we have to start that thread. So these are the two ways in which we can implement the thread. And we'll have some different life cycle of thread. So one is start, then runnable. So runnable is nothing but ready to run, and running is actually like it is running. The thread is running. Then thread can be blocked or it can be suspended like that, and after block maybe we can exit from the process, or we can go by running step, but you can't able to you can't able to move directly from blocked to runnable, sorry, running. First we have to be like ready to run, then we have to run. After complete execution we can put like or we can execute that. Okay, so let me give you a simple scenario. Assuming you are registering for a college, maybe for some courses, and you are waiting for the courses. So that means you are ready to join the courses. Now after doing that, doing the course is said to be running. For example, if you do some mistake and you got some suspension, maybe some temporary suspension. So that means you are going into a blocked state. So after some temporary suspension the management, the college is decide to like to terminate you from the college itself. So you can directly terminate from the college, or maybe like after some temporary suspension, after the suspension time is over, you can go to like ready to join. Then after that you can join the course. After successful completion of the course, you can exit the course by end like that. So this is like a practical example of like how to understand this kind of thread life cycles. Okay, so it will have the start runnable, that is ready to run, then run, actually the thread is running, then blocked is nothing but it's suspended like kind of thing, and the suspension normally it will have some days. So here also it will be given some milliseconds so that the thread will be suspended. After that we can either block, we exit the thread, or you can make that to ready to runnable. But you can't able to convert that blocked state into a running state directly, but you can convert that into a runnable state, from that runnable state into a running state, from that running state to a end state. So this is all about the life cycle of thread. Okay, so any doubt in this? So one of you have asked like, what is teaming? So this is like, first we have to create a thread which implements runnable. We have to write the code of it for implementation for run. We have to create the object for this thread one. Then what we have to do is we have to pass that to a main method, or to pass to a main class called thread constructor. So thread t main. So thread t main is nothing but the object for the predefined class thread, and we have to pass that as the constructor. So after doing that, we have to call this constructor, we have to use this object to start this run method. So this is like the t main indicates the object of the predefined class thread. Okay, any doubt in this thread? So that so we will see multiple threading in the next class, and we will see some scenarios like that. So before that, I will just want to print something like from 1 to 10. Maybe I will just show you some use of thread dot sleep. So for example, for int I equal to 0, I less than 10, I plus plus, like that. So instead of printing plus I, like that. So I want to create an animation kind of thing, so that first it will print the value 0, then it will wait for some milliseconds to print the next one, like that. So for that we have to make the thread to sleep some bit, maybe for 100 milliseconds. First we'll execute, compile it. Okay, so it's showing some error. Okay, so I have to declare that. Okay, so when you use thread dot sleep, it should be like it should be we should use that try catch thing. So let me put that as throws exception here. We compile it. Okay. So thread the. Okay. So we have to put that into try catch. Here we have to put try catch. Just let me check. Okay, so now if we type print demo, so it will take some 10 milliseconds, sorry, 100 milliseconds, and it's executing. Maybe if I give some 1000, it will execute in a slow manner. So first it's 0, 1, 2, 3, like that. So this is all about thread. Maybe in the next class, what we will do is, instead of creating a single thread, we'll create a multiple thread, so that we will execute these two threads simultaneously,
and we will see some some improper execution of this one. Like when you have like two threads more than one thread, when it is not controlled, it will be when it is not synchronized, maybe I would say, it will execute in a different way, so that it will give some improper result. So to overcome that, we use something called synchronized keyword. Maybe in the next class we will do, because it's like we will create some thread one, and the thread one it will print some even number of tables. Thread two it will print odd numbers. So when you do that, it will, when there is no synchronized thing, it will execute in a different way, and it will be get the values get collapsed, and it will display the values in a different order. So what we'll do is we'll synchronize that. So we'll do that in the next class. So in the next class, we will learn about creating our own exception as well as creating our own threads. Okay. So.